Okay, let me present the window. Okay, I think you all remember this question, the first question, the Mysore Jetra apps question, 10 marks. Okay, the five components. Yeah. Remember, yeah?
Remember, yeah.
So the five components of an information system, same thing, the hardware, the software, okay, and then the data. In this case, it's a information system in the form of a mobile app. Okay, it can be a mobile app, it can be a web app, okay, a standalone app, and so on. Okay, so that's why I told Ms. Teng. Oh, Ms. Teng, why database for RSD include this SAD question? And then, right. Perhaps it's due to you didn't cover PIS. Let me check. Yeah, I want to see, because this is our first time teaching RSD, of offering RSD. I want to double check RSD handbook. Okay, handbook. Okay, one moment. I double check first, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, let me. Okay, I find it already. Okay, let me show you. I'm not sure whether the one that I have is still the latest one or not. This is from your handbook. You already done semester one. I can see the web design and development here. Last semester you did database management 1053, and for this semester you are taking 18 hours. So one of it is SAD, and then there's a visual programming. You're taking FCN as well, and COA, followed by OO. Yeah, correct. You didn't cover the principle of information system. Okay, now I understand why they include the principles of IS, the basics of IS in database management. Because before this, you only covered IT fundamentals. Okay, now I understand. Because for diploma, database exam, normally they don't ask this. Okay, so that's why I was like, oh, this is new. And then I mentioned this to Ms. Teng. That's why I remembered this. Okay, so this one is already covered, has already been covered in database management. All right. We will be learning web app development, computer security. Elective one is here. Advanced. Okay, this one is after the fundamentals of computer networks. Data structure and algorithm, project one, project two. Then another advanced computer networks. When are you going to do your industrial training? In year three. Now you are in year one, meaning you have all the first 2 years to do the to learn everything that you need to know in order for you to do the internship. I see music appreciation, that's cool. And then elective 2, 3, and 4. I can see cloud computing, IoT, mobile app, software quality assurance. Okay. Now I confirm already my question from last week, whether you have covered any IS subject. So meaning SAD will be the query for IS. Okay, that's good. Now, what we're going to do today is, okay, let me show you my screen. I refer to our course plan first. Okay, in this course plan, I noticed that for tutorial, we're supposed to just do briefing last week, but we end up answering all the questions for tutorial one, right? And then in week two, this is when we're supposed to do the tutorial one question. So what do you want to do? You want to follow this, or at least since we are ahead of 1 hour in terms of our tutorial, we can sort of like have one extra 1 hour for our tests, or perhaps we can do some kind of revision. Okay, in week 14, we're going to cover the tutorial for chapter 13. Okay, chapter 13, there are two parts. Continuation. So, shall we continue as it is?
You mean like extra one?
Meaning we are ahead of the tutorial session, kan? 1 hour ahead lah. Because we already done this last week, right? So meaning this week, okay, like today, I'll cover chapter 2, and this coming Thursday, then we continue with tutorial 2, since we already finished off tutorial 1. What do you all think?
Oh, yeah. Just continue.
Just continue lah, yeah?
Just continue.
Okay, good. You all get ready with your slides, and then I will also present my PowerPoint. Then before that, I need to record the session as well. Okay, I'm presenting my second screen. So I think you should be able to see my Flowerist desktop. Okay, let me run the... Okay, I believe now you can see the slides, right, for chapter 2?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I think last week I forgot that I have two slides. That's why. All right. So chapter 2 is all about system planning. Oh, let me record first. Sorry about that. I'll start the recording. Okay, so let's start with this week lecture, which is on the chapter 2 system planning. And as you can see here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then there's one more down here, okay, which is the final phase. We have, in short, I always call it as PDO, okay, PDO. P, planning, A, analysis, D, design, another D is development, I is implementation, and the last one, O, is the operations, support, and security, also known as our system maintenance. Okay, so PADIO, PADDIO. Now, for every of our chapter will cover these stages or these phases in SDLC. Remember, SDLC stands for System Development Lifecycle. We will spend, I think, more than one chapters, two or three chapters, just to finish off system analysis, because this is one of the important phase in SDLC. Means if we perform the wrong analysis, then the design will be affected. When the design of the system is affected, then when you pass the system design specification to the programmers, when they do their coding, their programming during the system development phase, then they will end up developing the wrong one. So that's why emphasis is given in system analysis. But then before we can even start with system analysis, we need system planning. In system planning, we need to do a preliminary investigation. Now, notice that there's a document here. We call it a system request. So take note that system request is not one of the phases in SDLC, but we need system request, okay, to start off our SDLC. Means as a system analyst, we will not start our SDLC, the system development lifecycle, if we haven't received any formal request for a IS project from our client or from our user. So it means that we need the system request. Okay, so for this week, I hope you can memorize what does SDLC means and the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 phases of SDLC, PADDIO, P-A-D-D-I-O. Now, let's go to the next slide. Okay, in this slide, it explains about the system request, right? User will submit the system request to the system analyst. As what I mentioned just now, it is a formal request. Okay, a formal request for the services. And one of the requests, it can be a development of a new system. Okay, let's take your case study assignment. You have the bus ticketing, right? And then assuming that you have this bus company XYZ, currently they are doing it manually, all right? They don't have any proper system to capture the ticketing, the transaction to sell their tickets, right? So they fill up the system request and then ask for the development of an entirely new system. Or if you are assuming that your bus company is quite big and then they are already have been using the information system to keep track of their ticketing stuff, perhaps the system request system is to ask for enhancement to an existing system. Means they want to add in new modules, and or there's another scenario would be this time they want to expand their target to, of their customers, so they want to have an online bus ticketing system, right? So it depends. I will check out your presentation. I will see the background of your bus company lah, All right. So it all depends on the fictitious bus company that you're using for the case study. But then at the end of the day, what you need to remember is without system request, the life cycle will not continue. It's a formal request, right? Now, a simple system request, it can be in a form, okay? And it depends, yeah? If you work in a company and you are in the IT department, and then the IT department accepts jobs or requests from the... yes, Farah?
Oh, nothing. I accidentally press.
Okay. So say in a company, you are working in the IT department, right? And then you are accepting requests or IT jobs from the other departments. Then at the top here would be the name of the IT department for the company, lah. All right, meaning the IT department provides IT services to the other departments in the company. Okay. But then if your assumption is that we don't have any IT department, our core business is in logistics, okay, to provide bus transportation to our customer, we don't even have IT staff, then the scenario will change. It means that you might be getting another third-party company, all right, third-party company to develop the system for you. So in that case, that third-party company will have their own name here at the top, because they are the one who provide the IT service. All right. But then again, if you want to make it simple, then you can assume that in your case study organization, you do have the IT department. Okay, you do have the IT department, and at the top here would be the bus company name. Okay. Let me summarize what you need to have in this system request. Yeah. You must have the first section whereby you identify who is the requester. Example would be submitted by whom, from which department, and then the date of the request. Now, you can do your research. There are several, or there are various design of a system request form. This is just an example, so I will highlight the three main things that we need to have in a system request form. So the first one would be to identify who is the requester, along with what type of request they want to submit. One of it can be a new system development. Then number two, existing system. And then number three is just for maintenance, okay? Say for example, then there's an error, okay? They found an error and then they cannot continue with their daily job unless this error can be taken care of. So among the three types, correction of errors would be the highest priority. If you are the SA, you receive 10 system requests in one day from the other departments, you look for those requester who ask for correction of errors, because unless the errors has been taken care of, they will not be able to do their job. Okay, so three things: correction of errors, enhancement or improvement to the existing system, or the another bigger one would be develop an entirely new system. So that is the first part of the system request, to identify who is your requester and what type of request they need. And then the second section would be, if you look at this example, a brief statement of the problem, and by right, this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lines will not be sufficient for them to explain their problems. Then there's an additional instruction here that they may attach additional documentation as necessary. Additional documentation, if the request is about correction of errors, perhaps they can include a screenshot of the error messages and so on. Okay. Here they will explain what is their problem that leads to their request, right? And then over here is still with the explanation about their request, yeah. Brief statement of expected solution. Okay. Expected solution. So meaning, first of all, you need to understand what's going on, what's the issue, what's the problem, and then after that, you give some space for the requester to explain what do they expect you to do. Okay, if development of the new system, perhaps the requester will tell, we need to use the online system as fast as we could. Hopefully by the third quarter of year 2021, for example, and then solution of how many modules you want to include in the system and so on. So the second part of the system request form is very important. This is where you get the request to explain the problem that they face that leads to them requesting for services from your IT department, and you must get them to explain what they expect. So that one is under solution. Then how about the third section? The third section are meant for the IT department. Okay, meant for the IT department. There's no need for the requester to fill this one up. This one for internal use. So you can see here a list of action to be completed. Here, if the company, they do have the steering committee member, then it will be by the steering committee member. If the decision is done by the system analyst or the head of the IT department, then it should be changed accordingly. Action, it can be either request is approved or request is rejected, or keep in view or further investigation needed. Further investigation needed means SA will call up the requester, okay, ask for another meeting, get them to explain in further detail. And then here, analyst assigned. So this is the name of the system analyst. So if the action here is done by the head of the IT department, then he can assign which SA will take up this job and the start date and so on. Signature would be a signature by the person who filled this section, and also the date here. For the system request form, this is just an example. You can find much more better design of the request form as you do your research. Now, the next one is the sources of system requests. It means there must be a reason why the requester requests for development of a new system, or they ask for enhancement for the existing system, or they ask for correction of the existing system, correction, system maintenance. So we need to identify the sources. What trigger the system request? So all together, we have, let me, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, there are 5 sources. I want you all to remember this, because for your case study assignment, you need to be able to identify what is the source, or it can be more than one as well, the sources of system requests. This is also a popular question in the exam, right? Whereby you are given a scenario, and then based on the scenario, you're trying to figure out, the CO asked for the development of the new system. So you know the source of system request is what is shown here, directives from top management. Okay, so let's go through the five sources of system requests. It's five. So the first one is the directives from top management. Normally, whenever the IT department receive any directives or instruction from the top management, we cannot say, no, we cannot do that. That's why here we can say that directives from top management is in fact a prime source or a major source of system requests. This is what the top management wants, so they ask the IT department to do this particular IS project. Okay. Another good source of system requests is that there's a problem with the existing system itself. Now, if there's no problem with the existing system, I don't think the user will fill up the system request form and then ask for enhancement or ask for correction of errors, right? So here, if you read the scenario given, okay, and then you observe that, or the user, they're having difficulties using the system, or they are facing some kind of issues, errors, or inefficiencies, then your answer should be existing system is the source of the system request. If there's nothing wrong with the existing system, then definitely the user will not fill up the system request form, correct? And then the third source of system requests is the user's needs. Okay, remember that for any information system, the end users, they spend their hours, okay, working hours using the system. Okay, perhaps it's several hours a day, but then for data entry clerk, perhaps it's a whole day job for them since they're data entry clerk, right? So they do know, okay, which part of the system that is making their job slow down, and then they notice that if the system can be done like this, then it will be much more easier. Example, simplification of the steps. They saw that there's no redundancy in the steps, then I can enter the data easily. Okay, so again, we look at the user's needs. Okay, the user's need for new features to support any new task given to them. Or perhaps the manager. Okay, the manager, he needs to make decision on certain things, and then he notices, he goes into the system, there's no report that can provide information that I need to make the decision. So in this case, the manager might fill up the system request form and then tick under improvement to the existing system, add in one more report module in the system, okay, and then he will explain his problem, unable to make decision because the information that I require are not displayed or are not produced by the other reports available in the system. Okay, you can see a few examples given here, and let me go to the fourth one. The fourth one, external sources. Notice that the first three, they come from internal sources, the end user themselves who use the system. Now, the end user, you need to look at the scenario given. If the system is an online system, then the end user could be the customer, correct? If the end user is if the system is someone in the company using the system, then it can be the employee themselves, right? So whenever you see there's an online system, try not to like confuse yourself with the customer as the end user. So when you make your explanation, make it clear. All right. So in this case, external sources, it can be technology, it can be the government, It can be the customers. It can even be the suppliers. Okay, suppliers releasing new package. All right. So as long as the trigger comes from outside of the organization, then you can say that the main source of the system project comes from the external sources, and you need to name the external source. Let me give you one example. Previously, this was few years back, the government, the old government, they want to implement GST. And then what happened is that all the accounting software vendor, they need to make changes to their system to make it GST compliant. Otherwise, their customers or the clients will not be able to produce GST compliant reports. Okay, so you can say here that for this particular project, we need to develop a GST compliant accounting system, the external sources would be the government. Okay, because it's a government regulation that everyone must use GST. But then after that, when GST is no longer used, all right, then they need to change it back. Okay, not necessary to have a GST compliant anymore. Then the changes need to be done. So again, the external sources here would be the government. So you need to be able to identify a good system analyst before you can even start with the system development life cycle. You need to know what are the sources that triggers this IS project. Okay, and number five is the IS department. Why we include IS department? Because sometimes the top management or the end user, all right, they are lack in IS knowledge, in IT knowledge. So this is where the IS department itself or the IT department themselves, they're the one who will make the recommendation to the company. Why don't we develop an online-based or web-based system so that we can reach more customer? For example, since the economy is good and then we are on the right track, why don't we take it another level up, right? So the IS department, they know what they're doing. They know that they do have the technology. They know that they have the manpower expertise to develop such information system. Recommendation can come from themselves, okay? On recommendation by the IS department. So here I repeat, the five sources of system requests, it can be from the top management, it can be triggered by the problems produced or done by the problems faced by the user using the existing system, the users need themselves, the external sources, it can be new technology, government, customer, also supplier. And finally, the IS department. I hope yes, Noel?
What is EDI?
Oh, EDI. EDI is electronic data interchange. It means that normally, if you have a system, all right, and then you want to exchange data, both must be using the same system. Say your customer is another company and they want to purchase something from you. You are not using the same data format as your customer. So this is what we call as information system between these two companies should match, because if it doesn't match, you will not be able to do electronic data interchange. You can Google for electronic data interchange. Okay, good. The next part that you need to understand would be when the user requests for the IS project, you already identify what triggers it. Okay, the sources of the system project. I remember from here, a brief statement of expected solution. What do they expect? Okay, so it can be due to, if we have this new information system, we will enjoy improved performance. This is one of the type of improvement. Okay, improved performance. If you look at the explanation here, the current system might not perform as well as it must. So if you link this to this one, existing system is not that efficient. Okay, it gives problems here and there. So you already identify the source of the system request is the existing system, and the reason is to improve the performance. Okay, and then the second type of improvement would be better service. Okay, performance, please, if you have your notes, perhaps you can jot this down. When we talk about performance, we're talking about the information system performance. Okay, maybe the example given here, reports might take too long to prepare. So there's a way for you to make the changes to make the steps faster. Like if you want to do looping, which one is better? A nested while loop, a nested for loop. Okay, so these are the things that can affect the performance of the system. Or if it's an online system, perhaps the networking, okay, the connection and so on, need to be improved. All right, so it is on the system. Performance means the system performance. We're not talking about the performance of the employee. Okay, that's what I noticed. Yeah, student, when they use the word performance, they are talking about employee performance, not productivity, there's no productivity and so on. No, when we talk about performance, it's about the current system. The second one, better service, from the word service, meaning when we have this brand new information system, then we are able to improve our service, not only to our outside customer, but also to the end user, means our own staff, our own employee. So the system can be used to help the customer or the end user to do what they need to do faster. Okay, much more simplified. They get information what they need. Okay, better service to our either the customer or end user, depending on your scenario. Okay, so here I hope you can differentiate between improved performance and better service. Now let's take a look at the other types of improvement. Okay, these three you need to know as well. If I'm not mistaken, sources of system requests, types of improvements, you need to mention it in your case study, as well as this is also one of the popular question in the exam for diploma. I haven't seen for the degree one. Okay, so the third one, quality information. Okay, so this one can be triggered by existing system. Okay, existing system, say the report is not producing very good information for the manager to make the decision. Or maybe the users need, the manager himself, he discovered that he needs another a brand new report that can produce certain information for his job. Okay, or the top management, I want to see this info, but then there's our information system is able to give me this info. So it can be from either this or the external sources, the customer, they're using your online system. But then when they use the online system, oh, it's very difficult for me to find what I need. I need to click here, 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 here. Then I can see what I want. All right. So the sources of the system project, they are various, but it can point to the same thing. They want quality information. The reason is that the information produced by the existing system, it can be inadequate, incomplete, or it is not timely. Okay. Another type of improvement would be for effective controls. For example, lacking of the system itself, lacking of input validation, perhaps. Okay, controls might be inadequate, allowing erroneous data to enter the system. So if we don't, this one referring to the errors of, errors means the system cannot be used, right? However, it might be due to the inefficiency of the system due to improper or non-existence of input validation being done. I believe you have learned this in your programming classes, that you need to do a very simple input validation, perhaps the range, input range, or the correct data type that can be entered, the correct format to be entered. Okay, so this is what of the improvement required. We need to make sure the data entered into the system is not garbage. Remember, GIGO, garbage in, garbage out. We don't want to get erroneous data to be entered into the system. And then most of the time it is due to they want to reduce cost. If you notice, if we can say computerize our business processes, we can save costs in terms of the operation cost. What else? The salary, there's no need to hire extra employee, okay, to man the information system, or there's no need for the employee to stay back and then claim overtime just to finish entering of data into the system. So the thing is, when they want to make it cost efficient, they want to reduce costs, then that will be the correct answer. The types of improvement required is to reduce costs. Okay, so remember the types of improvement. What's is required? What do they expect when the new system has been developed, when the new or the existing system has been improved? So these are the five types of improvement, yeah. Improved performance, better service, quality information, effective controls, and reduced cost. Okay, preliminary investigation. I did mention earlier on, before we can even start with the system analysis, okay, system analysis is, I would say, a detailed investigation on the current system in order for you to develop a new one. Meaning you need to understand the current system, how it works before you can even develop a new one. That is in system analysis, means right after the system planning. Before you even do the detailed investigation in system planning, the first phase of SDLC, you must perform preliminary investigation. Okay, preliminary investigation, you look at the purpose here. To determine if the problem specified in the system request, remember the second section of the system request form is where the requester explain the problem that they face while using the system, right? Whether the problem specified requires a detailed investigation, means proceed to the next phase of system analysis. Okay. Here, we need to find out whether the source, the source of the project is valid or not. Okay, what's the reason? And then after that, you need to find out what's the true nature and scope of the problem, because we want to know initially how big is the problem. Will this be affecting the whole organization, or is it just affecting one department? Okay, the users of that department, there are only 3 users, so the scope is quite small. But then what happens if the company is quite big with 3 branches, 1 HQ? So the scope is bigger. So when you have bigger scope, when you do your feasibility study, especially the economic feasibility, when you do your budgeting, you need to put in a figures that is much more bigger, right? So if you compare this, you want to develop a new system for this department, having 3 employees, then first time for them to use the system, 3 employees, then you need to purchase 3 brand new PC. So you need to consider that in your economic feasibility study. This is referring to whether it's feasible or not. Okay, so that's why it's very important for you to determine the scope. Okay, how big is it? Okay, so what is the output from this preliminary investigation? The output would be the PIR, which is the preliminary investigation report. Okay, if you remember from our diagram, the SDLC diagram, input to the system planning is the system request. So the error before going out to the system analysis would be the PIR. And then depending on the PIR, the error can either go straight to system analysis, or it can go to another point where we label it as terminate the project. It means the project is not feasible. We are not going to continue to the next phase, right? Okay. So for feasibility study, let me check how many slides I have left. Oh, 20 more slides. Okay, how about we take a 5-minute break and I will continue the recording afterwards.
Okay.
5-minute break and we'll continue. Now, before I start, let me show you your tutorial too. Hope you can see the tutorial too. There are only two questions from system planning. You have this given scenario, and then there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 questions. This is what we're going to cover. Okay, technical feasibility. Under feasibility study, we have technical feasibility, we have operational and social feasibility, and another one would be the economic feasibility. Okay, there are 6 questions here, so you need to look at here. You need to make sure your answer refers to the given scenario. And then the second question is about the benefits, okay? Benefits for the information system. In this case, it's the point of sale system. Tangible benefit for the supermarket. Another tangible benefit for the customers. So these two are different. And then tangible benefits, intangible benefits, we will cover in this chapter too. And then besides that, we also have non-functional requirements. I'm not sure whether non-functional requirements is in the chapter one. We'll see how it goes. I cannot remember all. So what I will do is, I've already added in the Google Docs for this. Okay, let me show you. I'm sure you can see this. Yeah, this is our tutorial discussion.
Cannot see the screen.
I cannot see. How about the tutorial question just now?
Oh, screen. You didn't show screen.
The tutorial just now you also didn't see, huh? Oh yeah, I already stopped my presentation. Pull up, sorry. Let me see. This one. Okay, I believe we can see already. Let me show you one more time the tutorial question. Tutorial 2. I hope you can see already. Yeah? The A, B, C, D, F. Okay, the first question is all about the feasibility study, technical feasibility, operational and social feasibility, and the economic feasibility. These are the given question. Whereby CSC, they're using this particular current system, okay, but then there's a problem with the system, so they're proposing a new system. And then you can read up what is their proposal here. And then the thing is, they are not in the development phase of the system yet, but they are still in the preliminary investigation. They want to investigate whether it's feasible, whether it's worthwhile to proceed with the proposed system or not. Okay, so there are 6 questions here. Question number 2, we are still in the economic feasibility, where under economic feasibility, you need to know the benefits and the costs. Okay, for each of the benefits and the costs, there are intangible and tangible benefits. Question 2, there are only 3 questions. This is the point of sale system for the supermarket. They want to implement a new point of sale system. So the first one is tangible benefits for the supermarket. The second one is tangible benefit for the customer. And this one, I forgot already whether it's in chapter 2 or not. Macam ada, or if ada, later I will mention it during my lecture. Okay, so this is what I've already done just now during the break. In our Google Classroom, I add one more, which is the tutorial two answers, so that it will be faster. So Paris already in. So I wrote that last week. It was Kelvin first question, Kelvin, Noel, Paris. So now I will protect. So now Farah will go up lah, and then after Farah, then Kelvin followed by Noel, Farah, Kelvin, Noel. Okay, so just ready your answers before our tutorial class this week. Okay, so that's what I want to show to you all before I start with my second part of the lecture. Right. Okay, let me start the recording. Okay, are you all able to see my slide?
No.
No one? Okay, let me do one more time.
I think it's also not recorded.
Oh, okay. Always forgot entire screen. I need to select entire screen. I always go to, what was the second one? I always go to window. I need to select entire screen. Okay, entire screen. Okay, I'm seeing my screen already. Let me start the record. Okay, this is my slide and record meeting. Okay, sorry for the delay. I must remember entire screen. Okay, so for the second part of chapter two, we will see the feasibility study. Remember that during system planning, we are conducting a preliminary investigation. We want to investigate the true nature scope of the proposed system, and then we will see whether the proposed system is feasible to be developed or not. So in this feasibility study, okay, look at the definition given here. We want to find out whether the new system or the proposed system is viable or feasible. So when we talk about a viable or feasible, we will look at from the technical point of view, economic point of view, and so on. Okay, if we're talking about the economic feasibility, we will say that it is economically justifiable or economically feasible if the benefits itself outweigh the cost to develop the system. Okay, otherwise, then it's economically not feasible. Then we should be looking at, to find more not income, we don't use the word income, funds, okay, budgets to develop the system if the directive comes from the top management or the directive comes from the government, meaning we must implement the system, okay? Now, what's the main purpose of the feasibility study. Means what do we do during this feasibility study? First of all, you must identify the objectives. Identify what is the key technical and performance objective that the new system must achieve. You must identify this. Next, you must look at the requirements. Requirements, it can be, do we have the right technology? Okay, do we have the manpower, the personnel to who's going to say, for example, to use the system? Do we have this staff? And if we do have the staff, existing staff, how's their knowledge about IT, about IS? Do we need to give them further training? Okay, and then for example, our own programmer, our own system developers, do we have programmers with the right expertise? Do we need to send them from training, or do we need to hire consultant? All those things, okay. The requirements of the system, and then remember, we need to continue with the scope of the project, because from the scope of the project, it will help us in defining our costs and benefits. This one is, I would say, for students, this part is a bit difficult for them, costs and benefits, because when you look at, let me see, for your case study assignment. For system planning, you need to do your presentation two times. One is for the week 3 and another one is for the week 4. Week 3 would be the sources of system requests and so on, and week 4 would be the feasibility study, where student need to come up with a cost and benefit summary for the proposed system. You will not be able to do accurate cost and benefit if you do not know the scope of the project. Okay, and then you need to estimate the time frames also. Is it urgent? The correction of errors. Perhaps, not perhaps, this is the most urgent of all. So if they cannot continue the system due to the errors, then it must be corrected as soon as possible today, if can, tomorrow, let us by tomorrow. Otherwise, it will affect the employees' task, okay, the daily operation of the company. If, say, for example, it's a development of a new system, then we need some time to develop the system. It can be within a year. Maybe it can take more than 1 year. Okay, so we need to know how to estimate the time frames. For fresh graduates, I don't think they are able to handle or say have experience to determine all these things, to estimate all these things. That's why what I mentioned last week, that for a system analyst job, okay, normally they will put there, one of the requirements would be to have at least a 3 years experience, 3 years experience in developing IS project. Because of these things, you need to determine the requirements, the scope, the cost and benefits. To make a very good cost and benefit, it really needs some kind of experience as well. So I hope for this part, you will add more effort, okay? Do more research as required. And then constraint. Constraint, it can be various constraint. Definitely the money. If we have lack of budget to develop the system, say, for example, we don't have budget for, we have lesser budget, or we get budget cuts, then we need to think about where in our system development life cycle we can reduce costs. Perhaps it can be during the system implementation, whereby we can do a very quick system conversion from the old system to the new system. A quick system conversion, but then again, the problem is the quickest system changeover is normally the one with the highest risk. So again, we need to look at the overall scope. If it only affects one particular department having 3 employees, I think it should be okay. Why? If there's an error, okay, the system crash, it will only affect one department. But if it affects the entire organization, or if it's an online system and it will affect our customers, affects our suppliers, then we should not go for the most risky system changeover. So all this requires experience. Okay, so let's continue the types of feasibility study. So the first one is technical feasibility. Now, from the word technical, we will specify not only the hardware and software, but then the human requirements as well. Okay, human requirements, meaning do we have the technical expertise to run the system, to maintain the system, to develop the system? Okay, not only the hardware equipments, meaning your PC, your server, your networking equipments, and so on. Okay, so when we evaluate all these three, we are trying to find out whether the proposed new system is technically achievable or technically feasible. For the hardware, we will see whether it can support the number of increasing users. This one is normally an issue when we have online system. That's why during the system testing, we need to do or perform load testing or performance testing. We want to see up to what extent our system can process transaction, the volume, all right, the volume of the data need to be processed. The number of users can log in into the system at one time. Okay, so this is referring to our hardware and software. Technically, can we achieve it? Right? Response time. Okay, whether our system will be able to give a very good response time. So that one looks at our software itself. Okay, and then the output. Okay, whether the system is able to produce a certain output by certain deadline. If you notice, this might be useful for you. These examples might be useful for you to answer the tutorial questions. Okay, in terms of technical feasibility. Next would be the social and operational feasibility. You might be wondering, why do we need to assess the social feasibility? Here we're talking about the whether after the system has been developed, it will be in operation or not. Sometimes the source of the system request comes from the top management. Okay, the CEO mentioned, I want the Department of Marketing to be using a new system, develop the system for them. Okay, done. There's no problem with the economically feasible or not, because it's the directive from the top management. Definitely budget is included, right? But then the problem is in operational feasibility. The marketing department might say, we didn't request for the system, so we're not going to use the system. So something like a white elephant project. Okay, and then if you see here, whether the project can fit into the existing social and operational structure. So if we, the example that I mentioned just now refers to, what's the word already? Resistance. If there's a resistance from the end users, they resist the new system, they still want to use the old system that is much more familiar for them, then there might be problem with the feasibility in terms of operational feasibility. Okay, so we as a system analyst, as a system developer, we want to develop an information system that will be operational. Operational means the end user will use a system. Okay, you might be thinking why it will not be operational. We need to look at like employee skill. Maybe the employee that they are not welcoming the new system because they are the those range say employees in the range of 50, 60 above where they're almost retired and they are unwilling to learn new skill, okay, IT skill to use information system in their work. Employee motivation and resistance, say with this new system, then perhaps there will be change to another different section. Okay, there's a change in their working environment. So the job changes might affect their motivation. If they are not motivated, they are more inclined to resist the new system. No, I'm not going to use the new system. Okay, structural changes, high costs, all this might affect whether the system later it will be operational or not. Okay, this one ever happened to me last time. In this case, as the analyst involved, I cannot do anything because the directive comes from the HQ, from the CEO himself, okay? With the backup from the EDP head, and then with the finance director also giving her approval. So you are stuck in between the top management and the marketing department. And then at the end, the marketing department, they won. So this is my personal experience. So really, you need to understand how it works. So in this case, personally, as the analyst involved, I already know that, okay, it's technically feasible, it's economically feasible, but I don't think it will be operational feasible. But I cannot convince the top management because I don't have power, right? So in this case, you know what happened? The marketing department won, okay? So end up my effort to develop the system, okay, just going down the drain like that. A real experience, okay, something to share with you. So in this case, it's very important for you to do a feasibility study. Otherwise, you will waste your like 3 to 4 or 5 months of effort, okay? If one of it is not feasible, then we should not proceed to the next phase. So in this case, I still agree that SA should have years of experience because you need to communicate with both sides. Okay. Now, the third one is the economic feasibility. Economic feasibility, as what is mentioned earlier on, you have the benefits of implementing the new system, and then you need money to develop the system itself. So does this benefits, okay, from implementing the new system is greater than the cost to develop them? So in this case, you need to conduct cost and benefit analysis. Okay, example of cost and benefit analysis would be PP, payback period, and then ROI, return on investment. There's a ROI here, right? And then the third one would be the present value analysis, NPV, net present value analysis. So in order for you to find out whether the benefits outweigh the cost, you need to conduct the cost and benefit analysis. Example given here would be the return on investment. Okay, and two more would be the payback period and also net present value. Okay, So here, if you look at the issue, using the correct technique to compare costs and benefits. Just now I mentioned the three techniques, right? PP, ROI, and NPV. Which one should we use to find out whether the benefit there are more than the cost? We cannot just say, oh, let's just use return on investment technique. No, you should not do that. Sometimes if the ROI is around 30% return of investment, because ROI, the return should be in percentage, around 30%. It's not that high, but then it's still positive. There's a return, but then it's not that high. So should we consider it is economically feasible? Then we need to look at the payback period. So if normally for payback period, we are looking for a project that we can get back our money the fastest. So if the useful life of a system is around 6 years, and then after 6 years, definitely you need to replace it with another new system. Okay, but then the payback period is around 5 years. I don't think this is, if we consider payback period, this is economically feasible, because after using it for like 5 years, then we get back our money, means balik modal, developing the system, and the following year, 6 years, the system is outdated. We need to replace another new system, and then at the same time, ROI, return of investment, is less than 50%. In this case, I would say it's not that good in terms of feasibility, economic feasibility. There's another way for you to look at it would be the net present value. If the net present value is negative, that's a definite no. We should not go into this project. But again, if you look at the net present value, you need to use certain discounting method, 15%, 13%, 10%, and different discounting factor will affect the net present value. So the technique, to use the correct technique, you need some kind of experience. But then for my to make it simpler for you guys, if the payback period is short, ROI is a high, and the net present value is positive, we should go for the new proposed IS project. Okay. And then let's go to, okay, this is the continuation of the economic feasibility, because you need to compare the benefits and the costs, right? Okay, so let's look at what are some of the categories of costs. Refer this when you do your case study for week 4, if I'm not mistaken, where you need to do the cost and benefit analysis. Hardware and software costs, for example, hardware and peripherals, your PC, older printers, networking equipment, yeah, and then the software needed, the OS, right, the development tools if necessary. But then if the IT department already have these development tools, no need for them to purchase or pay for the license, then don't put in the cost and benefit summary lah. It means that if you need, the cost need to be paid, you incur this cost, then you include it in the system development cost. Installation cost, there's an example of new buildings if necessary. This is not for all typical scenario. Sometimes for a manufacturer, we cannot just install or set up the PC outside there where it is dusty. Okay, and then there's a lot of vibration, okay, and heaty. At the factory, we must build something like a room with an air condition, right? Okay, good good insulation and everything. So we might need to ready a new place for the user to use the system. This one is only if necessary, where it also includes the wiring, the furniture. But then if you can use existing furniture, no need to worry. Air conditioning is a must, especially for service and so on. Development cost, this one, you only include this if you're hiring additional expertise like consultant. If you're using your own IT programmers, right, they already have their monthly salary, right? So if you also put that in the development cost, then it's double. No need to do that. Okay. Personnel costs. Yeah, this is what I mentioned. If you require more programmers than what you have currently, say I only have two programmers, I need two more programmers if I need to meet the deadline of implementing the new system within 4 months. The target is within 4 months, but I only have two programmers. So you can add in two more programmers, then you can under the personnel staff salary for two programmers. Okay. And then if say for example you do have programmers, however, they don't have the skill to use certain as programming language, then you need to look at the training. Okay, training, get them to attend the training first. That one need to pay. Overheads, something like overtime. Normally for those in the software development, if the deadline is tomorrow, make sure you've complete it by tomorrow, because you are supposed to deliver the product, deliver the system to your customer, to your end user. You must meet the deadline, even if you need to work overtime. Okay, so all these are under personnel costs. And just to share something with you all, previously we did a educational visit years back to one of the software house company in KK. In their building, okay, they have a small gym, okay, with the table tennis, what else, the weightlifting, what else, all those typical gym equipment. And then at their rooftop floor, they have the court for badminton, and then downstairs, what else do they have? They have pantry, and they also have shower, what else? Lockers, okay? You might be thinking, oh, what a nice company. But then remember, as a software developer, sometimes they need to work the whole night just to meet up the deadline. So this is where they allow the programmers to distress themselves. Okay, they need to eat, they need to rest for a while. If they cannot go back to their house, they can just stay there, okay, and then take shower as long as they meet the deadline. Okay, so overtime, yeah. You can include overtime as well as necessary. You need to look at your scenario. You need to look at your assumption. Operating costs, whatever things that is needed for the operating of the system, like do printing. Okay, for backup, you might require the tape. Okay. What else? Stationery, the paper, all those. Definitely telephone. But then if you already have the utilities, no need to include. This is applicable if you have a new building and then you need to come up with a new computer room, purchase a brand new computers. then you need to look at all this. Okay, standby arrangement means the UPS, the uninterruptible power supply. Maintenance cost. Normally, students, they will add in maintenance cost. Maintenance cost for every year, how much you want to spend for maintenance. So maintenance, what do you want to do? Database maintenance, okay, or you want to maintain the computer, or you want to maintain the server, okay, all this to troubleshoot the computer, because before something went wrong, you need to do regular maintenance, okay. These are some of the examples for the cost categories. We can also group our cost by whether it is a capital expenditure, whether it is a revenue or recurring expenditure. For capital expenditure, they are one-off cost, means in your cost and benefit table, it will only appear one time. When? In year zero. Only in year zero. So year zero normally is the development year. And then you have year one, meaning the first year the system is in operation. And then year two, year three, up to the useful life of the system. It depends whether it's 5 years or 6 years. Okay, and after 6 years, then the system need to be replaced. Okay, one off cost normally during the development year zero, if you're purchasing the computers, okay. And then if this one return or purchase, in our system design, okay, there's a special case where there's no need for SA to design the system. This is when the management, they agree to, instead of developing their own system, they agree to purchase it from the software vendor. Means there's no designing required, but just purchase the system. When you purchase the system, the steps would be a little bit different, meaning you need to compare several available, commercially available software packages that you need. Okay, perhaps you, instead of developing CRM, customer relationship management system, you just want to purchase it from a reputable software vendor. Compare which one is good for the suitable for the company, and then select one. So this one, when you purchase, you are only purchase it one time. Okay, so it's a one-off cost. A recurring expenditure, for example, for support. Let me see. Recurring cost, training, perhaps not every year. Okay, training maybe in year zero, before the system is in operation, you provide training for the employees. And then afterwards, in another 2 more years, then you can provide another training for, say, there's an enhancement of the system. But then this one is just forecasting. Okay, so we might not know when we need to conduct these training courses, but definitely not every year. Stationary consumables, yes, this one is needed. So you need to know a way to estimate how much do you need per year. So will the user need to print the reports in 1 month, how much papers, inks, cartridges you will be required, it will be required, and then what else? How long will be the reports? Can it reach up to more than 10 pages per report, and so on? Okay. And another example for recurring costs would be the revenue expenditure, equipment or salaries and wages, right? These are similar to what we have here. But then over here, we didn't label it whether it's a one-off cost or whether it is a recurring cost. Means you need to pay this every year. If instead of purchasing the computer hardware where it's just a one-off cost in year zero, you need to pay the computer rental or lease every year, meaning starting from year one, year two, year three, year four, you need to add in the cost for computer rental, okay? Maintenance of computer power, this is the utility, and salary, okay? Salary for the staff who will be maintaining the system. Right, this is need to be included every year, recurring every year. It will you will incur this cost. Now, intangible costs. What we see all in these three slides, all of them are tangible costs. Means we can quantify it in monetary value. There's also another type of cost where we called it as intangible, meaning we cannot quantify in monetary value. For example, the learning curve cost. Learning curve cost means the user, they might make mistake when they first started to use the system, or they're not making any mistake, but they're doing their job very slow. Okay, they are not familiar yet with the new system. So we call it as learning curve cost. You cannot say, oh, staff and learning cost is 50 ringgit per month. And then for staff, learning curve cost is around 100 ringgit Malaysia. We cannot put an amount on it. It's not a good thing, but then it's affecting us. So instead of putting them as a benefit, we put them as a cost. We cannot quantify it in monetary value, so it's under intangible cost. Okay. Other examples of intangible costs would be the dysfunctional costs, where the staff, when they use the system, say they resist the new system, so they end up scolding the customers. Hopefully this one will not happen. Okay, when the staff themselves call the customers, will the customer come back? No. So we say that this is a bad, it's not a benefit at all. It's a bad thing happening due to the information system. So we put it as dysfunctional cost. Staff, they cannot function well. Okay. Incompatibility costs. Sometimes when we have a new system, it's not compatible with the one that we have. In this case, we need to solve that. The example given here is replacing the old system. Replacing the old system. Here, what we're talking about is if we have another system where we can get input from that system rather than we get our own user to enter the data into the system. But we cannot do that. Why? Because it's not compatible, the old system and the existing system. So in this case, eventually, in the near future, you might end up replacing the old system so that it will be compatible with the new system. So this is incompatibility cost. Okay, opportunity cost. It means you have this money, say 100K, okay, 100K, 100,000 ringgit Malaysia. Okay, and then other department, they propose something, and then there's another department, they propose something. And then for IT department, right, we receive this system request, okay, or there's a directive from the government that we need to replace our existing system to be, say, compliant to the new rules and regulation. So instead of putting in the money that we have to what they can what they propose, what the other department propose, we end up using the money to develop the new system. So this is what we call as opportunity cost. We decided to build a new system, but the opportunity to invest in another area is no more. Okay. Is it a good thing? No, it's not a good thing. So we don't put it under benefits, we put it under cost. Can we quantify it in monetary value? We cannot. So we put it as intangible cost. Now, this is one exercise. List the five main cost elements for procurement system. Procurement is something like purchasing system. And what is the potential benefits? I hope you can refer to this exercise answer for your tutorials or for your case study. Okay. Procurement system. You need to pay for the software. You need to pay for the hardware. Infrastructure means the networking lah. And then the implementation costs, like converting the old file into a new file format, training the user, and operation costs. It can be salaries of the IT personnel to run the system, to maintain the system, yeah. And then maintenance costs, if here it is provided by the software vendor and they ask you to pay for their service, then you can add it as maintenance, under maintenance costs as well. All these are tangible costs. Okay, potential benefits, source for alternative suppliers, therefore we can reduce cost of purchase. When we have a procurement system, it automates certain things and we can make good decision. For example, it's much more easier to decide we should procure this particular item from which supplier. In fact, in order for you to understand this, you need to know more about the procurement system business processes. Normally, it's included in PIS, principle of IS. So, since you don't take PIS, I suggest you to read more whenever you can. Right, the different types of business processes by different functional areas. Reduce unplanned or last minute purchases, because for procurement system, I believe it will be able to trigger the user when they should do the fill up the purchase order and submit to the vendor, to their supplier, because some this system, it can keep track of the inventory level. Purchase inbox, reduce purchase costs through discounts. Again, these are the information, quality information that we can get from the system. Okay, we get more in quality information. The user can make better decision making, and that translate to benefits that the user can get from using the new procurement system. So the rest are mentioned here, proper tracking of the purchases, the supplier rating, and then just in time delivery, JIT. This is in short JIT. JIT means you will only purchase what you need. When you purchase what you need, there's no need for you to keep all your stocks in another place. Means you can reduce the cost for your renting of a warehouse or renting of a store house and so on. Okay. Now, for benefits, okay, these are the answer for the exercises. So far, the explanation that we have gone through are for cost. we haven't covered the benefits yet. Yeah, question?
The answers are pretty open, very open-ended answers.
As long as it depends, it's logic for a procurement system, it is accepted.
Not fixed, that is.
No, not fixed. If the scenario say for an inventory control system, then it will be a little bit different. So this is where you need to rephrase your answer.
Quite a bit hard.
Of course, need
a lot of understanding to understand it.
Business processes, right? Yeah, you need to know understanding of business processes. That's why this is what I always tell my student. We are IT people, but we need business knowledge, like intro to business, intro to marketing, all those. For diploma students, they take this course, Principle of IS, where they learn the business processes for different functional areas like purchasing, marketing, finance, all those. But just now I checked your handbook, you don't have PIS. So you need to reach up more whenever you can, all right? Maybe articles referring to IS. Okay, so that's why for your bus ticketing system, you really need to reach up so that you understand what are the business processes happening. Okay, things that how do they sell tickets? How do they keep track of their buses? Everything, the business processes. For this question, it's all about procurement system. You are purchasing. You use this system to help you purchase items from your suppliers. Okay. Now we look at the benefits. We haven't looked at benefits yet. Okay. For benefits, again, it is categorized into tangible or intangible. Tangible means we can quantify it, quantifiable. Means we can put it into monetary value. For example, reduce of the operating costs, reduce of the staff costs. We know how much it is, like number of staff. If in average, the staff salaries around 2,000. So if there's no need for you to hire additional 2 staff, then you save around 4,000 per month. So per month times 12 months, that will be your saving for reduced staff cost per year. So this is what you need to do for your week 4 case studies. It depends on your story, the story of your bus company lah. Okay, increase sales revenue. This one, last time I asked my diploma student to, okay, how can you calculate your sales revenue has increased? So this particular group, they're doing hotel reservation system. So they calculate it like this. They calculate the average, okay, the average price that the customer pay. So how would you set your average price? We look at the cheapest hotel room to the most expensive hotel room. So we get the average, and then say in 1 month the room booking is around how many, then we calculate so they explain to me, and then I find that it's logic. Okay, increase in sales revenue. So say after the usage of the new information system, this increase in 2% of the room booking. Okay, I accept your answer. So please explain why 2%, something like that. All these quantifiable benefits, if it's quantifiable, you need to explain in Manila, all right? Reduce stock holding costs only meant for like inventory system, procurement system, yeah? Means there's no need to pay additional warehouse rental and so on. Reduce mistakes. I remember this one group, they put in reduced mistake as one of their tangible benefits. How do you calculate your reduced mistake? And then they assume the most common mistake done by the employees to charge the room rate cheaper room rate, but then instead it should be a more expensive room rate. So the most common one is the, and then how do you know that's the common mistake? Oh, we read up in the article. So they gave me all the research that they have done. Okay, I accept your justification. Proceed with your cost and benefit summary. Okay, so you can read up here. So let's see what's the next one. This one is intangible. Intangible means we cannot quantify it in monetary value. Say customer service, customer satisfaction. Can we say, oh, this month the customer satisfaction increased by RM1,000? We cannot say that, right? So it's under non-quantifiable. Improve of company image. We know that, oh, the bus company will be popular instead of famous for bad things, but then popular because of what? A very efficient ticket handling. Okay, I cancel my ticket and I get back my money refund immediately, for example. So improve the company image. It's not a bad thing, so it's a good thing. We put it under benefit. We cannot put it into money, means non-quantifiable, so it's under intangible benefits. So all of this, if you look at the rest, these are good things, right? Better decision making, more accurate information, more up-to-date information, even improvement of the staff morale or motivation. Good thing. When your staff is happy, then their productivity is good, then they can perform well, correct? Security, greater security, faster response times, all these are benefits due to what? Using the new system. Implementing of the inventory control system, the four tangible benefits, okay, and also the four intangible benefits. So we can see the example of solution given here. A reduced staff cost. I look at the explanation, justifiable, reduced number of staff required in warehouse. Yes, since we are using inventory control system, we know we can get updated information about our inventory, the current inventory stock, right? So there's no need for us to hire additional staff warehouse employee. Okay, we can get information from the system. Say the stock manager, the warehouse manager, he wants to find out for item A, can someone go and check? And then need to get another employee to do the checking, go to the warehouse, double check everything. But then, in fact, we can get the information from the system. And then things like the counting of stock, right? That one will need to be done, but then not every day. So that's another different story. Okay, better stock control. We don't want to keep those stocks that say after a few years, then you cannot sell already. Okay, like the quality is not good, already expired for food stuff, right? We want, and at the same time, we also want to reduce stock out. Stock out means it's the one of the most popular item, but then you cannot sell to your customer. What's the reason? We don't have stock, and then we need to wait for the purchasing manager to fill up the purchase order, send to the supplier, blah 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 blah. Okay, so better stock control. So if you can get money from solving this problem, then it's a tangible benefit. Okay, reduce operating costs. In this case, warehouse. Why warehouse? It's about inventory control. Intangible benefit. Look at all this. These are all those good things achievable by using the inventory control system. Like if you look at the justification here, the warehouse manager, even the sales manager, they get timely and up-to-date information. Okay, the warehouse staff. So this is how you can refresh, yeah? Like Kelvin, just now you asked, Is it the same or different? It will be different. So if it's inventory control system, then you need to mention all these names. Okay. Who will require stock balances info in a fast time, faster time? One of the user would be the sales person, yeah? Because when they want to sell the customer, do you have enough stock? Because I probably need around 1,000 units. So the sales personnel, he just need to log in into the inventory control system. Yes, we do. We can we do have the 1,000 units, right? So you need to rephrase your answer accordingly depending on the question given to you. I think we are okay. Last three. What's the time now? One more minute. Let me just finish this. Okay. Where's my screen? Oh, one moment. Okay. I remember I mentioned about the cost benefit summary. This is what you need to show to me for your case study lah. The rest of the type of questions mentioned in the tutorials are already covered in our lecture. If you see from this cost benefit summary, you use this format. Okay, this is the title. This is for the name of the IS project. Okay, you normally divide it into cost and then benefits. Okay, you list out whatever costs and whatever benefits here. Okay, definitely it's for tangible costs and tangible benefits where you can calculate or you can quantify it in monetary value. Look at the year here. Year zero means it's a development year. So I would say that the consultant fee of 14,000, purchase software 2,005, hardware 5,000, consultant training 3,009. This one is a one-off cost during the development year. Year zero is development year. Year one is the first year the system is in operation. Year two, year three, year four, year five means I can see here the useful life of this system is 5 years only lah, whereby after 5 years it need to be replaced. And then for the cost, I can see the maintenance backup update. It's a yearly cost. Notice that in year zero, it's lesser compared to the other costs, recurring costs starting from year one to year five. This one is to make it simple and simpler, then it will be the same lah, almost the same. This one is lesser because I believe there's not so much of backup and updating required lah. So you total it here and then the benefits eliminate over time. So if you add in this, normally I will ask, how do you calculate this? Okay, like in year one, 1989. Okay, how do you calculate eliminate over time? Okay,
need to be realistic, the numbers.
Yes, definitely. I'm not sure whether I still have or not. Perhaps one of these days I can show you how my diploma student justify how they calculate eliminate errors like eliminate over time. As long as that is a logic, I will accept it.
We need to reference real other examples so we can justify.
Yes, very good. If you can justify
other company,
make sure other company is similar to your own company, a similar field. Okay, same system. Like for example, one of the diploma student, they use what was their case study? Hilton Hotel. They managed to go and find what was it? The maintenance to the cost to maintain servers, because Hilton Hotel there is not a small hotel, right? like it has Hilton hotels globally, correct? So they managed to find the cost. I told them to give me the URL, put it in your appendix, and then during the presentation, they're able to do that. Yeah, so I'm really satisfied with how they justify. Because as a system analyst, how would you do this all these things if you don't have experience, right? So for students, the only thing that you can do is to read a lot, to refer to lots of articles. Okay, hopefully you are able to do that. Okay, and another example given here, let me continue a little bit more. This is another example, the name of the system. Again, year 0 to year 5. Sometimes I will ask the student, why year 5, not year 6 or year 4? And then they justify. For this system, it's always updated very fast. So ours is until year 4, okay, something like that. Here, the tangible cost is a little bit different. And you notice that there's a support contract. So normally for the tech support, it's not meant for the development, during the development, because in this case, they are purchasing a software package from software vendor. So they only pay like 500 per year to the software vendor. And then here, the purchase price for the software package is 3,000 times 3. So they paid in installment, okay, 3 years. Then they finish paying for the whole price of the software package. They purchase new hardware, blah, blah, blah. To install the software package, you total them up. Okay, the same benefits, right? Eliminate additional position means additional staff. And one thing that I want to remind you all is that students sometimes get carried away. They do all these very nice costing benefits, and then I told them I reject your project. Why, miss? We already show you all the justification. We count it correctly. Blah 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 blah. Can you check whether your total benefit outweighs the total cost? Hiya. Is the other way around. The total cost is more than total benefit. So make sure to make it economically feasible. The total benefits here, it must, you need to total this one, and then you total this one minus. If benefit is greater than cost, means it's economically feasible. Right? That's one thing that you need to do. And remember the output for preliminary investigation is PIR. This is an example of the report where it must include the cost and benefit and the recommendation whether should go to the next phase or not. So I believe we are done already for today. Sorry for the extra 7 minutes. Any question before I end our meet? Are the tutorial questions already at in the Google Classroom, the Google Docs? Just need to answer accordingly.
Oh yeah, miss. The weekly deliverable.
A weekly deliverable. For this week, only in classwork. You will only do presentation next week.
I mean, do we start during the in classwork or before?
If you have time, it's better for you to do research and then finalize what you need to show to me on Thursday because we only have like around 1 hour. Remember, only for this week, you only need to do in class work, right? But then starting from next week, you need to do both in class work and also presentation. And then remember, I need to do briefing for the next week and the following week as well. So only this week you are a bit free lah. Any other question?
No.
Okay, so I'll stop the recording. That's all for today. Bye bye.
Okay, thank you, miss.
Thank you.
Welcome.